this morning. We're playing a song that I truly love. That before the battle started, before it even started, I don't know about that. Maybe y'all ain't never had no battles. Maybe that's what it is. Maybe y'all never had a battle. But if you can just think about any battle that come your way before it even started, he said, we already won. I mean, really think about that. So, what does that say to you at that moment? All he wants us to do at that moment is just ride the wave. Just ride that wave. Now, I'm not saying, because you know I love you, just gonna make it plain. I'm not saying in riding that wave you won't have some challenges. I'm not saying you may not cry in the midnight hour. I'm not saying that sometime your mind may be a little bogged down with some stuff. But if you can agree, even in the midst of that, no matter what you throw at me, Jeff, I already won. No matter what come, I already won. Yeah, it don't feel good right now. But I win, y'all. Not just me, but you. So before the battle starts, we, you and I, we got this. How come we got this? Because he got us, right? We got this because he got us. I need y'all to understand that on this morning. Well, I'm here to go before you all, or I'm here before you all, for us to do this declaration. And I say it so many times that I say this declaration when I'm not here, because I need this declaration to help my mind stay just right on the path that God has helped me stay on. So I pray that you will say it with meaning on this morning, knowing that this is what God has for you.
Glory to your name.
Come on here, y'all. It says, I am purpose,
to be a
life changer.
I am purpose,
to be a kingdom citizen,
of Yahweh.
I am purpose, to be a changer of atmospheres and those around me.
I purposely
bring every demonic thought,
into captivity,
immediately.
I purposely
walk in no lack,
no fear,
no condemnation, but in power,
love,
and a sound mind.
Hallelujah.
I purposely decree.
I believe something magnificent is going to happen in this atmosphere.
to exhort you. It's to get you prompt to do something. And as I'm in expectation of what God is going to do, because I'm so honored to have our spiritual parents here, Mama Sam, Daddy, Daddy Cunningham. I'm so elated. And I was led to go to the scripture, James 4 and 10, and it says, if you humble yourself, he will exalt you. And that lets me know, Pastor Turner, that there's a process from humbling to exalting. Because you got to do something before he does something. But I started looking up that word humble. And humble in the text, it means to depress. And I know a lot of times we struggle with depression. And see, the reason why we
come on here now.
What oppressed is two opposing forces. But if you can just get in the flow of God and stop working against him and stop working for him, I just believe God enough that depression will go away, because what you're really fighting is your new you. Welcome to Life Changing Christian Center. This is your new you. This is your new you. That means getting out of the press. That's getting out of the opposition of what God is trying to do. But it also means to fully give yourself unto him, to fully devote yourself unto him. And why is that important? Because I believe today is a monumental time of not just elevation and recognition of the ones that are standing before you, but I believe today is your day of elevation. I believe your faith is going to be elevated. I believe your ministry is going to be elevated. I don't believe in coincidence. I just believe God. And this is an appointed time. And so humble means to completely devote yourself unto him. And that's to give him your everything. And even as I was studying that, it said even your carnal ego. Because there's no place for ego in the kingdom. It's just God. It's either you're sold out or you're not. You can't be lukewarm in this season. We need some boiling hot people that can change the atmosphere. Because when they came in, they were already hot. And that's what stirs it up. You don't need no hype, man. You got the Holy Spirit. You got your testimony. But when you begin to humble yourself, give him your all, fully devote, it will change your perception. Why? Because I gave him all of me. So, Bishop, that means if I give him all of me, he'll give me all of him. And all of a sudden, I won't have to worry about him being second during the week and just first on Sunday. Now when I give him all of me, every day of me, 24/7 of me, 365 of me, I recognize that there is no option. I realize that he has nothing but good things in store for me. It changes your perception. Even those things that hurt are really there to help you grow. When you're in the flow of what he's doing in your life. And here's the secret. Y'all want to know the secret?
Yeah, come on.
Part B of that was, and God will exalt you. But really what's happening is now you're living in your heavenly places. Now you're living at the right hand of the Father. Why? Because you fully devoted yourself. You stopped going against what he was trying to do in you this whole time. He was just trying to grow you. He was just trying to promote you. He just wanted you to see you how he sees you. That's all.
That's all.
Everything that you went through, you just overcame. How do I know that? Because you're here today. You're here today in your right mind. You're here today still giving him your all. So if you humble yourself, give him your all, he will exalt you. Why? Because now I'm exalted in my mind. My mind is exalted to think of him as the only option and not second choice. He's my first thing I think about when I'm faced with a decision. He's not the last choice. He's not the wishy-washy one. He's not my last resort. He's my only resort. Because he is my God, and he's the one that put me in my mother's womb. He's the one that formed me and knew my unknown parts. He's the one that puts
stars in the sky, but it's so amazing that he can go into my mother's womb and form everything about me. And as he was forming me, he was writing the days of my life. So he knew everything that I was going to experience, everything that I was going to go through. And I thank God, because the scripture says he'll never put more on you than you can bear. But sometimes it seems like it's too much because you're in the press. You're opposing him instead of flowing with him. So get in the flow today. That's what I'm exhorting you to do. Get in the flow.
Yes.
Stop pressing against him.
Thank
flow
you.
With him.
Flow.
And watch you go higher. Flow. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, man. We got. Oh, my God. I got so caught up, y'all. Because we got so much going on today. Like, I was going to put the mic down. But in honor of our spiritual parents, we have some more things that we want to bless you guys with. And this woman of God that's going to present this gift as a testimony all by herself. But I mean, we're so honored to have her in here, even though I told her not to be here. But it's good to see a walking, moving testimony. And it's good to see what God can do. And so she's going to present some more gifts to you guys, because we're just so glad y'all are here.
Let me just say this. As she's getting this stuff together, this young lady just got out of the hospital yesterday.
Yesterday.
Amen. Yesterday.
Yesterday.
She pressed her way. She told the doctors and all that, I'm going to be at the hospital, because she has such a great heart to serve and to bless our man and woman of God. But we want to thank God.
Yes.
Even though she's hard-headed, but
yes.
We thank God, because she is a true example of pressing through. Her and her husband,
yes.
They both stayed up, and her kids. What she couldn't do, she got all them to do. And so we wanted to thank God for them, for being a blessing, for us to be a blessing to our man of God. So at this time, we're going to allow her to come forth with the gifts here. Amen.
Amen.
We have some amazing, talented people here within the ministry that truly has a heart and a desire for God's people. Yeah. Yeah, show them the shirt. Rocky, that's the Rocky. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Give God some glory. Amen. We have always been taught that the anointing that you honor is the anointing that you shall receive. And we thank God for our spiritual parents upon today. Amen. I'm sorry Kim took over, but I wanted to just give the blessings of what this young lady has done. So, okay. Yes, we have Minister. Yes, sir. Okay. I thank God for this young man who's coming up here to minister to us in mind. He has been with us so faithfully. We had someone else that was supposed to be here, but they weren't able to make it upon today. And so at a last minute's notice, he stepped in for us. And so we thank God for this awesome man of God from the University of Montevallo. He is another adopted son that we have. That has always been at the house and all of that great stuff, but he is so faithful to the ministry and to his cause. So we're now going to welcome to the stage Mr. Terrence. Boykins. Yes, there you go. I'm so excited, man. So Terrence Boykins, God bless you.
Anybody want the Lord to make them over?
Is that we don't have the ability to make ourselves open. We don't have the ability to free ourselves. But the good news is the work that it takes to make us over has already been done. It has already been done. On Calvary's mountain, the cross, the blood. What can make us whole again? Nothing but the blood. We don't talk about that enough. We don't preach about that enough. We have lost our faith in the blood, but that blood is still flowing. That blood is still there with you. That blood is still there for you. And so I thank God for the blood. I praise God for the blood. I give him glory for the blood. For the blood. My praise almost got me there, but it didn't get me over. My worship almost got me there, but it didn't get me over. But if it had not been for the blood, the blood that flowed from Emmanuel's vein, the blood that's still flowing for me and for you, that blood, it never loses. Never. I may have storms, I may have ups and downs, but the blood never loses. A lot of us have gotten to a point in life where we put so much faith in our struggles. We put so much faith in our haters and all of that. I choose to talk about the blood. I choose to talk about his goodness. You worried about a political party, I'm talking about his blood. You worried about this, that, and the other, I'm talking about his blood. I praise God, and I pray that we have a Damascus moment. Amen. That we have an encounter with God. that your flesh, the fake you. And I love the word Damascus because it takes off the mask off of us. Demask us. And can we say, Lord, right now, demask us. Demask us. Amen. I know your heart may be heavy, but take off the mask of fakeness so God can heal the real you. So God can set forth the real you. Praise God. Because a lot of times God can't heal the real you because the fake you is too much in your way. The blood don't work on the fake you. It works on the real you. And as we're crying out, you got to be careful. You got to be careful when you ask the Lord to make you over. Amen. Amen. Because he may break away some things from you that you don't want to be broken away from. Amen. So you got to ask yourself, are you really wanting a makeover? Are you really wanting God to make you over? Amen. And I believe I'm in a house of some saints of God that is already made over. Amen. I believe I'm in a house of some saints of God that are already redeemed. And the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. So let me hear the redeemed of the Lord say so. Wow. Listen, I am excited to stand up here. What an honor it is to be able to introduce my spiritual father. There is never a Sunday nor a Bible study that goes by that you will not hear me mention.
Amen.
Three names. That's God, Apostle Maurice K. Wright, and Apostle Andre Cunningham.
Amen to that.
Amen. 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 Where I am today and who I am today is because of this man of God right here. He took me into his home, woke me up at 5 o'clock in the morning, laying hands on me, praying for me. But what I cherish the most about this man of God is I lived with him between 3 to 6 months. And the man of God that he is and he was at church was the same man of God that he was at home.
Amen.
Amen. He didn't wear a mask.
Come on now.
He told me like it T.I. is. He corrected me a few times, but I love him to life.
Amen.
And as they always say, beside a good man is also a good woman.
Amen. Amen.
Mama Sint has to be one of the sweetest women. I so thank God for her. She is a quiet, soft-spoken assassin.
Yeah.
Don't let that smile. Yeah. If you wrong, you wrong. And if she tell you wrong, just take it. Amen. But I praise God for her. I love her. She has been such a blessing. They both walked with me through the challenge of last year. And not only did they walk with me, they also walked with my wife. They helped the both of us through some challenging and tough times. And I can go on because I oftentimes say that my spiritual dad is like the word of God. I can talk about him all day long.
Amen.
Amen. But I am so excited to have him. And let me just say this. This house, this church, is because of our faithful seed sowing into them.
Come on now.
Into
Come
them. On. Amen. 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 See, most people want to know, how did we get what we got and where we are? Because we sold into them. Our time, effort, finances, everything, we sold into them. And this church is a harvest because of our faithfulness to them. They are great ground, not just good ground, they are great ground. So I am now going to introduce to some and bring forth my spiritual father, my spiritual daddy, Apostle Andra Cunningham. God bless you. This is.
Thank you, Lord.
You feel the presence of the Lord in the parking lot.
Yes, sir.
God is in this house. Amen.
Yes,
amen.
If you are able to stand, can you just stand for a few moments, because it's so important that we honor the man and woman of God.
Yes, sir.
That resides over this house.
Yeah.
That God has called and
sent
man and woman of God.
Yes.
It's a difference than being in place than when you are set by God. Because you can't move a set thing. You can always replace a place thing. But when God sets something, it is permanently as a fixture. Amen? And they are angels of this church. So I want to ask you, just give God a wonderful hand clap of praise for these wonderful people. How about you do better than that? They are precious, wonderful. Oh, hallelujah. We bless you. We love you so very much. Amen. Wonderful example of sons and daughters. And we do want to honor them as they have done. We never like to go anywhere without honoring the people of God. As Apostle Horton put it, that's some bubblegum money there for you. But listen, I want you to do me another great, wonderful favor, because you have walked in the state of excellence. We entered to the hotel and we was greeted with a basket that weighed us down. I felt like the man coming out of the promised land with the grapes had to get some help. It was so much that blessed us with, and we wearing our jewelry, Ms. Neville and Deacon Neville, we wearing it. And we appreciate all of the gifts and the work and the time, but something even greater I do want to appreciate and want to honor here today is that just as the man of God and the woman of God that went through so much last year, you know, to get to this point, because the enemy realized what God had in store for them. And he worked so hard against them. But what God has for you, no one can take away. Do I have a witness there?
Amen.
No weapon formed. Come on, somebody.
Right.
I said, no weapon formed.
Amen.
But see, oftentimes, what the man of God and woman of God go through, you will soon begin to experience the same things in your life.
My God.
And you begin to see the enemy begin to work hard on you.
Right.
And so as you begin to get into this place here, you may experience how the enemy is trying to hold you back and try to work in different areas in your life. But just as you saw the man and woman of God, that they press
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And persevere,
yes, sir.
You took on that same nature,
yes, sir.
And press and persevere.
Yes,
so I want, like Changing Christian said, I want you to put your hands together for yourself. For what the Lord has done for you. Come on, put your blessings hands together. Oh, you can do better than that. Come on. What the Lord is doing in this house. Hallelujah! My God. The world has not seen everything that you have sacrificed on behalf of the Lord. And we just praise God for you so tremendously. Amen. And for the people that's going to be commissioned here today and pardoned unto. Amen. We give you the praises as well. Amen. Put those blessings together for them as well. You can take your seat if you don't mind. I want to do something that's a little different here today. And I want to, rather than have a structured sermon and the Lord flow in that particular direction there, I want to do something that's a little different because of the occasion that we are in right now. And it's so good to see George and Dean. God bless you so very much. Always so good to see the beautiful family as well. Amen. All the wonderful people that's here. So many
So many familiar faces that are here and wonderful people, many people that's online are gonna see this as well. But I want to do something that's a little bit different here today, because I believe that the Lord designed to leave an impartation unto you. So I believe I am on an assignment released on behalf of the Lord. So as the Lord determined the assignment, he will allow certain graces and certain mantles to be in operation according to the assignment. And I didn't want to come here as a preacher, but I want to come here as an apostle and release some things in the atmosphere as impartation. And that's okay for us to receive. Amen. And I believe what the Lord has for you will take you into this next decade here. I believe it's going to be your best decade of your whole life. Let me say that again. I believe it's going to be your best decade. I didn't say your best year. I said your best decade. You got the next 10 years to praise God for what he's about to do in your life.
Jesus.
Somebody just look at somebody real quick and say, the best is yet to come.
The best is yet to come.
Listen, I want to be able to minister this real quickly to you, and we can be able to look at a certain passage of scripture, Luke chapter 10 and maybe verse 5 and 6. And I just want to read quickly through that, if you don't mind. I'm going to go to different places. And this is the type of flow here where I believe God will have me in, that it will be the spirit of revelation, the spirit of wisdom where I just begin this flow. And I may not always stop and read scriptures and just paraphrase scriptures unto you, but please feel free to write down the scriptures so you can be able to study. But the Bible said, all you're getting, get understanding. Don't have a witness?
Amen.
The word understanding is another Hebrew word for experience. You're going to experience the word of God. You just can't have a mental reception of the word. You must have an experience with God, because when you get an experience with God, it trumps every opinion that try to come against you. Don't have a witness out there. It doesn't matter what people's opinions are. When you have experience with God, amen, my spirit trumps every opinion. You can say that God is not a healer, but when God has healed my body, come on somebody, that's my experience, and you cannot overcome my spirit. I'm a witness out there. That's what the word understanding means. It's all in all you're getting. Get experience with God.
My
God. Yeah. Hallelujah. So Luke chapter 10, verse 5, it says, this right here. It said, into whatsoever house you enter, first say, peace be to this house. And if the Son of Peace, and it's very important that you understand the verbiage here, the understanding here, because you read it in the Messianic Bible, the Hebrew Bible, it begins to say, if the Son of Peace be him rather than be there, your peace shall rest upon him or it. If not, it should return to you again. I want to be able to minister real quickly there, bless all the peacemakers. For they shall inherit the earth. I want to be able to minister to the people in this house, because God began to share with me that he can release, not only the atmosphere of peace, but he's going to release peace over you, that wherever you go, you're going to change the atmosphere.
Amen.
Hallelujah, somebody. Hallelujah. Wherever house you enter into, you're going to change the atmosphere.
Yeah.
Oh, God. Wherever job you're working at, you're going to change the atmosphere. Hallelujah. Matter of fact, God is sending me here to let you know, amen, that you already have been changing the atmosphere already. So this is a confirmation word unto you, amen, that wherever you are going, wherever God sends you, wherever state you enter into, wherever city you enter into, wherever country or nation you enter into, amen, that peace that God has placed on your life will change the atmosphere. Hallelujah, somebody. And so I want to be able to minister this unto you here this morning, but I also want to begin to talk about the elevation, the apostolic elevation that Bishop Valentine is releasing in this house. And it's very important we understand how God does a thing.
Yeah.
And so we must understand that the word staff and the elevation of the staff, this is not a new thing, but this is something that was symbolically done throughout the scriptures.
Yes, sir.
It was done oftentimes, even in the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament. As a matter of fact, every time the staff was raised in the old covenant, whether you're talking about a wooden staff or even you're talking about a people, they're literally synonymous. But anytime they raised the staff, something was happening in a heavenly realm that transformed that staff. Wow. It released something over the people who had their eye on the staff. Oh, I feel an anointing on this already. And so we must understand this is historically evident throughout the scriptures that God oftentimes will elevate staff to let the people know I'm getting ready to shift the whole movement.
Come on here now.
You haven't seen anything yet. And so I want to be able to release here, Bishop, imparting to the people of God and to those who are here and the staff that are here, amen, the different dimensions or the realms that peace is going to give in this house and in this region. Let me say it again. Not just in this house, but in this region, God will release a level of peace, amen, the impartation to let the enemy know that you had just stepped foot in his territory. Woo! My God, happy Holy Ghost. I'm trying to stay calm and not preach here because I'm getting kind of silent already, though. And so you must understand that even from the point of Moses, so many people, they focus on the wrong things, amen, in the scriptures. When we talk about Moses and her and Aaron, and when Joshua went down below and he was fighting the enemy, the Amalekites, and he was fighting them down below in the village. The Bible say in Exodus, the 17th chapter, and you can begin around the 9th verse. Many people started at the 10th verse, but they missed the 9th verse, because the 9th verse was really important. But they look at the 10th verse, the 10th verse begin to talk about how Hur and Aaron and Moses, they went up into the mountain, and Joshua went down below with the army and began to fight the enemy. And the Bible say, and they raised Moses' hands. In the air. And every time his hand was raised in the air, Joshua and the army was prevailing against the enemy. But when Moses' hand began to drop, the enemy was prevailing against the army of Israel. And oftentimes people focus upon the hands of Moses as though he was in a prayer position or in a worship position. And oftentimes they related to a worship moment, but it wasn't really worship. The focus was not the hands of Moses. If you read in verse 9, chapter 17 of Exodus, the focus is not the hand. The focus was in the hands of Moses. The Bible says that he had a rod, which is also similar to the staff. So he had a staff in his hands, and every time he raised his hand, he was also elevating the staff. So every time he elevated the staff, amen, Joshua in the army was winning in the battle. Y'all not hearing this. Amen. But every time the staff got lowered, the enemy would prevail against the army. So it wasn't so much as his hands were being lifted, it was that staff that was being elevated now.
Yeah.
What you say?
It's good.
But the staff cannot be elevated unless it's in the hand of the one who God appointed to raise it. Because the staff cannot elevate itself. Come on here, somebody. It must only be elevated by the shepherd that has it in his hand. And no other shepherd can handle the staff except the one who has been called to handle it. Let me go just a little bit further. If it's so you can really catch and really understand this, because we must understand that the staff, it's important. It's the only equipment that the shepherd has when he deals with the sheep, when he is with the sheep. He don't have no other equipment. He's not carrying around. He's not like us. He's not carrying around a pocket knife. I don't know if we got met up to Texas here or not. I don't know what you packing. I don't know. You may, like me, you come from the hood, you know what I'm saying? Some of your purses are kind of big. I don't know what's in there. But the shepherd didn't have a whole lot of different equipment. He only had one equipment, which was the staff.
And it's never used for much of a purpose. It was used only for guiding the sheep. It was also used for discipline, correcting the sheep. But it was also used to defend for the sheep. Just in case a wolf or something like that was to come unto the sheep, he used the staff. Y'all not hearing it. He used the staff. Y'all still not hearing it. He used the staff to defend the sheep. Y'all not hearing it. The shepherd didn't have to fight. He used the staff to fight off the enemy. Oh, y'all need to see this. He didn't have to correct the sheep. He used the staff.
Oh, yeah.
And so you must understand that the staff is important, but you must understand that the staff unto the shepherd is not a crutch.
Wow. That's good.
Staff is not given to weak shepherds who only use it as a crutch. Y'all not hearing that. God only gives strong staff to strong leaders. Oh, hear me, God. But only a strong leader can handle a strong staff. I mean, there's a strong staff that's in this house here this morning because you got strong leaders of God here. See, you must understand, a staff, amen, is not used to lean upon as a crutch. It's used for multiple different purposes. Can you go ahead and bring those staff, those two staffs up? So they can have a better visual understanding, amen, of what they are. Because we must understand, amen, that the staffs are used for multiple different purposes. But the staff is only as effective as much as the shepherd is able to elevate it.
Wow.
The greater he can elevate it, the greater he can be able to use it.
Wow.
And so a staff is not a cane. Most staffs are at least close to the same height of the shepherd.
Amen.
Oh, this is good. Because it must measure to the length of who he is in the spirit.
Wow.
Oh, happy God.
That black man.
And so yeah, just come on up here. This man, hit me out there, right? So you just there. So listen, let me show you real quickly. This is one staff here that I have. And you must understand that this staff looks different than this staff. Do I have a witness in it? It looks different, but both of them are staffs. But we must be careful because most churches are looking for a staff like this. When it's smooth and it don't have any nits or it don't have any cuts or it don't have anything in it to show it been through anything. I'll hear me, God. And most people, most churches and most pastors, they trying to look for something like this. But can I help you out? This stuff was man-made. It was made, amen, by a group of hands of people. I wish I had me a witness. It took man to mold this together. And it may look shiny. It may look smooth. But it hasn't been through anything. I need something that's been through some things. Hallelujah, somebody. I need something that got a story. I need something that got a testimony. I need something when I look at it, I know it's been through some battles. It's been through some wars. Don't have a witness here. So when I look at this right here, I see this right here have been through some stuff. Come on, somebody. Because this is not smooth. This is rough right here. It's rugged right here. I can tell, amen, whoever put this together, amen, is what natural. It was not man-made. They cut this from the tree. So that means it's been through some storms. It's been through some trials. It's been through some heat. It's been in the sun. I wish I had somebody. He had to fight out some things. He had to war some things. But it made it. It's still here standing. That's the type of staff that God is putting together. He's not looking for something just to look cute. He's looking for something that ain't going to knock the devil upside the head with him. Hey, glory to God. I'm looking at some warriors up in here. I'm looking at some devil chasers up in here. I'm looking at some demon runners up in here. Who are here? Who let the devil know you can't do nothing against me and my family, my marriage, my children, my great-grandchildren, my great-great-grandchildren, my body, my mind, my health. The devil is alive. sick. Can I help you? Some of you have went through some stuff recently because he was qualifying you. Not so much as for everyone else to know, but to let you know that if I could take you through all of that, and you still made it with your hands in the air, oh my God, if you still made it, and you still praising me, you still shouting out, you still running out, you still believing me, every time my hand is upon you, thank God. Take us through some things so that we can have the confidence of who God is. Oh, we got confidence in Bishop. We got confidence in Prophet CC. But sometimes God got to take us through some things to let us know that God is in us. Hallelujah, somebody. And so you must understand, amen, that staff, it can't be just any staff. God bless you, dear. Thank you. It can't be just in this venue somewhere close. I can get back to it. It can't be just any staff. It got to be staff that God is making. It got to be something natural because only the super can fall on the natural. It can't fall on something man-made. Only the super can fall on the natural to make it supernatural. And so let me help you. Let me go a little bit further. Amen. So the first realm, we'll talk about Moses real quick. Moses was the first realm of what's being released in this moment. That when you are elevating the staff of bishop, when you are elevating the staff and the staff is raised, this is what with Moses and Joshua is indicating, amen, that God is about to release victories in the house. Oh, help me God. Every place where the enemy believes that he has victory, whether it's in someone's marriage or whether it's someone's body, oh my God, it is going to supernaturally, it's going to turn around on their behalf in a midnight hour. I don't care if you believe it or not, God's going to do it anyhow. He's not waiting for you to believe him because he's God all by himself. If you deny him, he's still God. There's some miracles, amen, that God's got to say, I got to do it for my glory. I got to bless you for my glory. I got to heal you for my glory. Hallelujah. Sometimes he'll make a believer out of you where you halfway didn't believe. But God said, I'm going to make you a believer because it's for my glory. I wish I had the hell with us. Sometimes we didn't believe that the doctor can heal us and we went into the surgery anyway. But God said, I'm in the midst of the surgery. I'm your surgeon. I'm the doctor, the healer. Physician who never lost a patient. I wish I had somebody who would have been God is a provider. He's the healer, he's the deliverer, he's the way maker. And the truth be told, we don't always believe.
Wow.
Sometimes God had to make us a believer.
Help us.
Please understand this, because I was raised, amen, during the faith movement generation period. So I understand about the legality of faith. But please understand this, God does not need our faith for him to be God. He was God before there was faith. And he'll be God after the, well, I wish I had me somebody. He didn't need faith for him to be God. Amen. We need a faith for him to know that he is God.
That's so loaded. Come on here now. Whoa.
So somebody tell somebody real quickly. He's releasing the impartation. He's releasing the impartation now. He's releasing it. He's releasing it. You better receive it. You better receive it. There's victory in the house. There's victory there. Don't question it. Amen. I'm trying to figure out this figure in there. Amen. There's victory. Let's receive it. Let's receive it. Let's receive it. Don't try to figure out whether it's real or not. It's real. Let's receive what the Lord is doing. If you keep going. Another way that stuff can be used, and this is something that's often missed in the scriptures, because we often look at the end of a thing rather than the journey. And the journey just is important, looking at the end or focus upon the end of a thing. But I'm going to go back to 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter, around the 40th verse particularly. Because this was during the period in the time where David getting ready to go to battle against Goliath. And he was trying the armor of King Saul. And told King Saul, Saul, I cannot wear your armor. Because I have not been proven in your armor. But around the 40th verse, as he took off the armor, you begin to see what David began to do. The Bible says he took his staff. He laid down the armor of the king. And he took his staff. And the Bible says he went towards the water brook. Oh my God, you gotta follow me on this. He went toward the water brook, and then he found some stones, five smooth stones, and he put them in his grip on his bag. And then he went, amen, into that paddock, and that's when he took the sling in the other hand, had the staff in the other hand, and he swung it, and it hit the giant, and the giant fell. Wait just a minute, let me back up. Let me bring some clarity to that, so you can understand what was happening. As I said before, David, who was a shepherd, the father's, keeping the father's sheep, he didn't need the staff to lean upon, because he didn't have a handicap. He wasn't disabled. He was a strong man who had a strong staff. I want to have me a witness here. And so what did he need a staff for? You must understand the purpose and the assignment of the staff. So he took the staff, he went to the water brook. And so you must understand, he took the water, the staff, and he moved it in the water brook. What was going on? First thing, he used the staff to tap into the flow. Oh, help me, God. Let me just slow this down for you. In other words, the man of God, he see the movement. He see what God is moving. He see, amen, what God is getting ready to release. But he don't want to step in it by himself. He's going to use his staff. And his staff is going to tap into the flow of what God is doing. But what is the purpose of tapping into the flow? Amen, to tap into the flow was meant for the staff to make clear so he can see the fine smooth stones. You must understand, amen, because there's a lot of stuff that's in the flow. And not a tiny enemy trying to contaminate on what God is doing. But the staff, amen, will remove the clutter and remove the mess and remove the muddle and locate the fine smooth stones. I wish I had me a witness. You must understand what that fine smooth stone represents. They represent the fine rims of the anointing. So the staff, amen, will tap into the fire rim of the anointing when they tap into the flow of the Holy Spirit. What are the fire rims? Can I just go ahead and talk about that for a few moments? The fire rim of the anointing, it deals with the fire senses, but it's in the spirit realm. God will anoint the staff to flow. I'm behind the curtain right now. This is not even a sermon. This is a Ephesian epistle letter being written to you right now.
Come on, now.
The five rims of the anointing, it deals with the anointing of seeing.
Come on, come on.
The anointing of hearing.
Come on,
Jesus. The anointing of speaking.
Jesus.
The anointing of touch. Hallelujah, somebody.
Oh, my Lord.
Just by touching someone, or someone touching you, the virtue will flow out of you.
Jesus.
When you tap into the flow of the Spirit.
The flow of the Spirit. My God.
The anointing of smell. What does smell have to do with the thing? It's called discernment.
Yeah.
You can discern when we enter into the room before they enter into the room.
Come on here. Jesus.
Just by the fragrance. It's called discernment. So God is getting ready to release five rims of anointing in this house.
Glory
upon
name.
The staff.
Glory to your name, God.
You will begin to tap into the flow.
Jesus.
And watch this. Not just in this house, but when you go other places with your man and woman of God.
Jesus.
God will release an atmosphere. They will tap. I don't care what kind of atmosphere it will be when you get there. When you get in the house, you will change the atmosphere.
Yes,
help me, God.
Yes.
There's going to be some intercessors going to be lined up. There's going to be some prophets that are going to be lined up. And they're going to begin to speak in the atmosphere. They're going to say something is not right. Amen. My man and woman of God, get ready to minister. So I got to change this atmosphere. I got to intercede. I got to lose some angels in this house. I got to lose the Holy Ghost that's in this house. I wish I had me a witness. So the staff is not just there to observe. The staff is not there, amen, just to look. The staff is there to make a difference. The staff is there to raise the temperature. The staff is there to bring the fire. The staff is there to change the atmosphere. Let me keep going real quickly. Jesus. Another area. Y'all still with me?
Yes, sir.
I say y'all still with me?
Yes,
are y'all still with me?
Yes, sir.
Another area that we need to understand that the staff is raised. The staff is often used, Bishop, to carry the Ark of the Covenant.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
They could not carry the ark just on their shoulder without the staffs.
Yes.
The staff had to go into the rings to watch it to elevate.
Wow.
And when they elevated the staff, they elevated the ark. And the ark represents the glory. So let me help you out. So therefore, since the ark was on the staff and the ark represent the glory, that means the staff were glory carriers.
Oh my God, my God.
Oh, help me God. So watch this, you gotta understand this. Since they were glory carriers, that means they manifest the glory presence of God wherever they go. The staff, someone say the staff. So let me go a little bit further so we can really catch this. Every staff is made from a tree.
Amen. Wow.
All right. I see it.
Let me say it like that. Every staff from God is made from a branch of a tree.
Yeah.
Y'all still with me? I'm almost done now. What lands on branches of a tree? Birds. Because birds feel comfortable to land and rest on a branch. Because the branch is strong and stable. Oh, help me God. Are y'all still here with me? I'm talking about the staff. So let me go a little bit further in history in Genesis. When Noah released the dove from out of the ark, he released the dove out of the ark. Amen. During the period of the flood, and he was waiting for the receding of the waters of the flood. So the Bible says he released the dove out of the window of the ark, and when it went forth, the dove went forth. It brought back. Watch it. It wasn't an olive branch. That's what it say, but it was an olive stem that had a leaf and fruit.
Wow.
And so the dove brought back that evidence unto Noah to let Noah know that the waters were receiving, which means there was peace. Because when the water was rising, it was chaos, and it was confusion, it was unstable. Are y'all hearing that? But since it was receding, the dove came back to give evidence unto Noah, there's peace that is arising now. But watch this, it did not have rest, because it came back to the ark. Y'all gonna catch this? So Noah waited a little while longer, and this time when he released the dove did not return. Why? Because he found a branch to rest on.
Yes, sir.
Oh, help me God. Where you going, man of God? Well, let me help you out real quick because I can tie it in for you. Because when the dove broke, amen, that stem from an olive tree with the leaf and the fruit, and you gotta catch that. Amen. And often you often see the picture internationally of different countries. Amen. Where you see a dove in its beak, it has an olive branch. And it often represents peace. Someone said peace. Oh, hear me, God. And as a matter of fact, even on your money, on some of your money, on your dividends, amen, it have an eagle, amen, that have an olive branch that is holding it, representing that peace. Let me keep on going. Oftentimes when people say that, they say they want to have peace between us, they say, let me extend an olive branch. In other words, they coming in peace. Are y'all hearing this right now? And so the olive tree and the olive represent peace. Y'all have a witness there. And so the dove, amen, is a messenger of peace. But a dove can only rest on a branch that has stability and that has rest. He can only rest on a branch that has rest. Y'all sit here with me.
Yes, sir.
And so you would believe that the story ended in Genesis. But it was only symbolic of the Bible saying that everything that was done was done as a foreshadow. It was done as a prototype. It was done as a precursor, as a fulfillment of what Jesus was going to do. And so I had to look, amen, that was in Genesis. So I had to go to Matthew. Because Genesis was the first book of the Old Testament. So I went to Matthew, who was the first book of the New Testament. I said, well, show me a branch and show me a dove. And God took me to the Jordan River. And the Bible said that Jesus, out of Isaiah and Zechariah, that Jesus is a branch. He's the stem of Jesse and that branch of righteousness. And in the Jordan the River, there was a branch.
Extended.
And the Bible said, and the heavens open. And they're descending down. Was it? Watch this. Y'all didn't see that. And descend down from the window. From the window of the ark of heaven. A dove came down. So you got to catch this. When the dove came down, the Bible said, and it rested
on the branch. Yes, sir.
Let me help you out. So you got to catch this. Because watch this. The branch was stable, it was strong, and it was rested. So that the dove can, watch this, not only land, but stay. Because you would never read when a dove lifted.
Come on, help! Jesus! Have mercy,
my God, my God.
It only said that the dove landed on his shoulder. Then you hear the communication from God. Are y'all hearing that?
Yeah.
It never said it lifted and flew away. Why? Because it found its resting place.
Right,
right.
So let me watch this. So it found a resting place. It rested on a branch. And since the dove, watch this, symbolically, it was the Holy Spirit. And watch this, symbolically, he had some oil in his mouth. Which was the Holy Spirit. So he's basically saying, I'm bringing peace. Because he is the Prince. And his name shall be called Peace and Truth. So somebody look at somebody and say, man, it's getting heavy and deep in here. So watch this. John the 14th chapter said this right here. John the 14th chapter said this right here. It said, and in the latter part of the chapter, he said, a peace I give unto you that the world cannot give.
Yes, sir.
Why can the world give it, Jesus? Because the world don't understand this kind of peace. Their definition of peace means without conflict.
Come on.
That's as far as their peace can go, without conflict, without argument, without strife. That's that definition of peace. But my definition of peace means wholeness.
Yes!
means nothing missing, nothing lacking, nothing. Y'all not hear that? Nothing broken. It means you are whole. Come on, somebody. Not just on the outside, but you are whole on the inside. Whole from your past. You are whole from your present. I want your hand mail with it. I don't care what you've been through. I don't care what you're going through. I don't care what you will encounter tomorrow. You are whole in the name of Jesus. I don't care what other people are saying. I don't care how hard it may have been. Maybe Apostle Paul will say, you have peace that surpasses men understanding. They don't understand why you still praising. You've been abused. You've been misused. You've been confused. But my God, he's still raising you up. He's still blessing you. He's still raising you in the midst of your enemy. Because God gave you peace. You must understand that peace. Peace is not just, it's not just verb. It's not just a noun that we can shout about. Can I help you out real quick? But peace is the substance that the atmosphere of heaven is made of.
Wow.
They breathe in peace into heaven like we breathe in oxygen down here.
Wow.
They are so accustomed to peace. Because in the third realm of heaven, there's never been a conflict. There's never been a battle. As far as the enemy have done, he only got to the second level. Because peace would not allow him to come to the third region of heaven.
Wow.
Oh, this is good.
Wow.
And so peace is something different in heaven. It's a commodity. Amen. It's greater than bitcoins in earth. Y'all didn't hear that. It's greater than that. It's greater than gold and silver and platinum. It's greater than all of that. Peace is a commodity. It's a substance that the atmosphere is made of in heaven. And so everything, all the saints that are with the Lord, the angels of God, amen, God on the throne, they only familiar with peace. In a word, whole. Hold from their past. Hold from their hurts. That's why there won't be no crying on. Let me keep going here. Got to stay on that for a little while. Let me share this with you. So in John the 15th chapter, when Jesus said John the 14th chapter, I give you peace that the world cannot give. Then John the 14th chapter, 15th chapter said something really unusual. Because in 15th chapter, he said this right here, I am the vine, I'm the true vine. Yeah. And watch it. In every branch in me. Wait, I gotta get it. Every branch in me must bear fruit. Yeah. Come on, somebody. What fruit are you referring to, Jesus? Well, I'm the branch that's referred to in the Old Covenant, in the Old Testament. And so when they talk about the branch or the tree, he was referring to the olive tree.
Oh, my God.
Right. Israel is referred to as the olive tree.
Right.
Paul called Israel the olive tree. Come on, somebody. And so Jesus referred himself as the olive tree, as the olive oil, as the Holy Spirit. Let me keep going here. So therefore, watch it. The fruit that he's referring to are the olives.
Yes.
And the olives represent peace. Y'all didn't hear that. And so therefore, he said this right here. He said, every branch in me, amen, they must produce much fruit. In other words, they must have some peace. Amen. You can't allow people to take your peace. You got to protect your peace. How would y'all have me a winner? I don't care if people from your parents. I don't care if people in church. I don't care if people on your job and your family. You got to protect your peace. I don't care what devil. I don't care what demon. Tormenting you. You're going to protect your peace from your past, from your hurts, from your wounds, from your frustration, from your pains. You're going to protect your peace so you can bear much fruit.
Yes.
Let me say this, staff, branch, branch, staff. Let me say this, staff, branch, branch, staff. Let me say this to you. The enemy, if he's going to mess with you in any area, being the staff, he's going to try to mess with your peace.
Yes, sir.
Because he realized he can't mess with your gift. Because your gift cannot be returned back. Come on, somebody. You can be tore up from the floor, but God would not take back his gift on your life. Y'all need to hear this. You're going to remain gifted until Jesus come back. Because that's what Romans 11 and 29 say. I wish I had me on with it. But you must understand, the enemy realized he can't take your gift. He can't take your calling. But he can mess with your peace. If he can mess with your peace, he can mess with your prayer. If he can mess with your peace, he can mess with your money. He can mess with your peace, he can mess with your mind. If he can mess with your peace, he can mess with your joy. He can mess with your peace, he can mess with your marriage. He can mess with your peace, he can mess with your health. He can mess with your peace, he can mess with your anointing. You gotta protect your peace. Jesus did what you're doing. He took the 12. He elevated the 12. And then he sent them out. And they were branches. It was time for them to bear fruit. And then a year and a half later, the Bible says, and then he turned around and then he elevated 70. Let me go ahead. I see it, Lord. I see increase coming in the house. Oh, God. I see increase coming in the house. Amen. And I see multiplication coming out. Yeah, he elevated the staff today, but it's going to come a year that God is going to multiply the staff. There's going to be a bigger branch, and there's going to be an extended branch. Oh, help me, God. He's going to branch out from this place. Oh, look at your neighbor and tell him, ever, God, you're going to branch out of a life-changing Christian center. Let me help you. I gotta close this thing. So he elevated the 70. The Mount Sinai was the first elevation that Moses did. Because he took them, the bottom, the foot of the mountain was literally called the outer courts. There were three levels to Mount Sinai. And it was a certain place, amen, that the people could only go. And then halfway of the mountain was called the holy place. And only the priesthood could go there. Aaron and Joshua, you read, they only went halfway, amen, which was the holy place. But Moses was allowed to go to the top, the summit of Mount Sinai, which was the most holy place, the holy zone, where God was, the cloud was. And so God told Moses, I want you to build the tabernacle according to this pattern. There's three regions. And so therefore the tabernacle literally represents the mountain of Sinai. It was a portable mountaintop. And so when God called in the 70 under Moses, and Moses said, Moses got a 70 people that he was going to anoint, he placed his spirit upon them. They went into the tabernacle. Amen. So God could release Moses' spirit upon the 70. Y'all need to hear this. Amen. But the tabernacle represents the mountaintop. So it was a moment of elevation for them to receive an impartation. Hear this. Wow. Jesus did the same thing, amen, with the three. He left the nine at the bottom in the outer courts. And you know, what were they doing at the bottom, the nine? And they were dealing with devils.
Jesus.
And at the top, at the summit, there was Jesus, Peter, James, and John. And then there was Moses, and there was Elijah. They was at the summit.
My God.
The holy, holy of holies.
My Lord.
Y'all hearing this? So anytime there's an intervention, there's an impartation. We all got to get this. And so Jesus realized this. He talked to his disciples, the 70. He said, listen, amen, I'm about to impart unto you my peace.
Yes, sir.
And therefore, my peace is atmosphere changing. You don't really have to do anything. Anywhere you go with my peace, it's going to bring healing. It's going to bring deliverance. It's going to bring restoration. Y'all wish I had me. Somebody, people are going to be begging you to come to their house. Amen. Because, not because of you, but because what I release upon you, I'm releasing my peace upon you. It is atmosphere changing. It is life changing. It is men and women changing. My peace I give unto you. He said, where would you go if they receive you? Leave your peace. Speak unto the house, peace. Be unto this house.
Yes, sir.
That's it, I get it. Let me get one more time. I'm tied up and I'm closing. I'm releasing. Jesus said this right here. He slept at the bottom of the boat during the midst of a storm. Can I tell you why he slept? Because in the atmosphere of heaven, there was no storms. It's only peace.
Come on.
I'm not saying that you won't ever experience a storm in your life. Because I'm telling you, amen, even after this day, amen, the devil is going to try you. Amen, trouble is going to try to find its way. Amen, that you're going to still experience this and that. Well, what I'm telling you is, there's a choice that you got to make. There's an option that you have to make. You can either choose a storm or you can choose peace. You can choose trouble or you can choose peace. You can choose sickness or you can choose peace. I don't know about you, but I choose peace. The world saying we're in a recession. The devil is a lie. I'm not part of that system. I'm in the kingdom of God. I'm the one in peace. I wish I had a man with. The doctors say I got this and that. Peace in my life. I say peace over my children. Peace over my marriage. You have to choose which reality you want to live in. I'm not saying you want to experience trouble. I'm just saying there's going to be another reality. You choose which one you want to live in. So Jesus told me that. He said, when you get there, tell them peace be unto this house. Or let me go back. So let me finish that story about Jesus. So Jesus was sleeping at the bottom of the boat. The rainstorm was raging. And they woke him up and said, do you not care that we perishing? They woke him up from out of his peace. And so he got up. Now this is very important. You need to read the scripture, not just read the scripture. When you read the scripture with the eyes of the Holy Ghost, you see something that you have never seen before. But when you read the scripture, it says this right here. Jesus woke up and looked at the situation, the circumstance, what was going on. And this is what he said. Peace. The word is capitalized.
Yes, sir. It is.
It's capitalized as though it's personalized. Because Jesus was familiar with peace. He wasn't given a command, a verbiage command. He was told in heaven that. Boy, now you didn't get this. He was calling heaven down in the midst of the storm. And when heaven kissed the earth, kissed the waters, kissed the storm, we're not familiar with this. We used to storms. We used to chaos. We used to confusion. But heaven had just stepped in my situation. And peace is here now. And so the storm ceased. The rain stopped. Why? Because peace was there. So when Jesus told them, he said, be you so high, just simply watch it. Once again, read it. It say, capitalized. Say, peace unto this house. It's capitalized.
Wow.
He would tell them to release heaven.
Release heaven.
Jesus.
Yes, God.
Now this is what he said next. He said, now if they receive you, then leave. If they be a son
of peace. Don't leave out some peace. If they be a disciple and a believer of who I am.
Yes, sir.
If they believe in who I am, then they can keep what you left.
Wow.
Oh, y'all been hearing that. In other words, I'm going to release peace on you. And you can release peace on them that ready to receive it. Oh my God. And then watch together. Notice the words. He said, and they shall have your peace. You can walk in peace so strong, Jesus can say it's your peace now.
Wow.
Yes, Lord, I hear you.
To your man or woman of God a while ago. Matter of fact, when y'all was in the school, I think it was your fifth or sixth anniversary. And I said, what God gave me to do, he's going to release. Watch this. Not even a full harvest, but like a down payment. Like earnest money harvest.
Wow.
This right here, just earnest.
Come on now.
You know what earnest means, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
It means the house is coming.
My God. Yes, sir. Yeah.
Something greater is coming.
Yeah, yeah. Glory to your name. Hallelujah.
That was fucking a few years ago. Yes, God. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we release peace unto this house. Blessed are the peacemakers in this house, for they will inherit the earth. Breathe on them, God. Breathe on them. Heaven abode all around them. Everywhere they go, they're going to experience the peace of heaven. Even with trouble, try to trouble them, they won't be trouble. Because they will have peace. I speak healing through peace right now. CC, I speak healing over your body. Minister Neville, I speak peace over your body. Yes. 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 Minister Maurice, I speak peace over your past.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I heard the Lord say, just let go.
Wow.
And let him. There's peace there now. Yes. You all will be ministers of peace. Yes. Even your worst enemy won't be able to stir you up. Yeah, I hear it, Father. Let me go ahead and say it. I'm going to turn back over to Bishop. I hear the Lord saying, every unforgiveness, every anger. Yeah. Someone say, I have anger problems and all this stuff. In the name of Jesus, he's pulling at all of you right now. And you're putting peace in place of it. You won't ever be the same again. You won't go back. You can't go back. Yeah. It's a supernatural thing. People talk about the drugs that you do and how you get high. You try to go back to that same fix. When you get this peace, it will be the greatest experience you will ever have. For those of you that are ready to walk greater in peace, I want you to put those blessed hands together. And you say, I receive it, God. Come on, say it to the Lord. I receive it, God. I receive your peace, God. Oh, come on, that's it, that's it, that's it. Receive it. Receive it. Come on, he poured it out. He poured it out. He changed your atmosphere at home. He changed your atmosphere at home. Dance, God. Dance, God. That's it. That's it. He's doing it. He's doing it. He's doing it. Yes. Yeah. Come on. Glory to God.
Trying to follow the protocol, but man, I just pray you can feel what I feel. His presence is so real.
Yes, God.
This time last year.
Come on, come on.
I was fighting for my life. And Apostle, you didn't even know. But the nurses and the doctors and people were coming out of the room and do all they were supposed to do. But they would just stand there and wouldn't leave. Because they always said there's so much peace in this room. And it's right when COVID hit and all the fear. And all the way down to the workers, the cleaners, the people, the janitors. They would just come to the room and they would say, Mr. Valentine, we don't want to leave. And I didn't understand. understand.
Yeah. Wow. Hello.
But 1 year later.
1 year later.
1 year later. Come on.
Yes, God.
Wow. Hallelujah.
As you were speaking, I heard the Lord say that.
Thank you.
That spirit has found a resting spot.
Wow.
Yes,
God.
Lord.
Thank you.
Hallelujah.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. Hallelujah.
I must say, man, if it wasn't for this woman right here.
Come on now. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Thank you, Father. Thank you, God.
This ain't about us, but I just got to say that this woman here.
Thank you.
Never left my side.
That woman right there.
And I wouldn't
have left you. She still sees you. Even in the glory. But that's what I praise God for her about, because she always kept a smile on my face.
Thank you, Jesus.
Laughter. Apostle, Mama Sin. Words can't describe it, just to say thank you.
Thank you.
Amen.
Thank you both so, so much. Okay. This time I'm going to ask the ministers, those that are being elevated, Deacon Neville, ministers, and Pastor Turner, to come to the front right here for me, please. And the spouses. Praise God. Now, come on. Yeah. I know you're working. And yes, yeah. We had four ministers to, I wouldn't say they preached that first Sunday, but they preached. And I think Apostle preached on every last one of their messages. I think he was all in Derek's message. He preached on peace. That's how you know we are definitely in the vein of God. Before we go forth, I just want to say how proud I am to serve alongside such great men and women of God. You guys make pastoring easy. Y'all make it enjoyable. And I love each and every one of you to the bottom of my heart. Y'all are so amazing, and I'm so excited to see where you grow and where we go from here as a staff. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to read to the congregation to hold these men and women of God accountable to the office in which they are walking into and being elevated into. And so after I read this, I'm going to ask you all a question to uphold them, and you're going to answer that we will. Amen? Amen. These persons are, by God's grace, to be licensed or commissioned to ministry in Christ's holy church. Those authorized by the church to inquire about them have discerned that they are persons of sound learning and of Christian character, possesses the necessary signs of God's grace, and have demonstrated profound commitments to serve Jesus Christ. Therefore, we believe them to be duly called to serve God in the ministry. We ask you, people of God, to declare your assent to the licensing and commissioning of these persons. So to the congregation, I ask you,
will you uphold them in their ministry and calling? Amen. Now to you, the candidates. My sister and my brothers in Christ, you have been called to a commissioned ministry. The church now confirms your calling. As commissioned ministers, deacons, and elders, you are to be co-workers with other church members and leaders in the church. Remember that you are called to serve rather than to be served, to proclaim the faith of the church and no other, to look after the concerns of God above all. And so I ask you to the leaders, do you believe that God has called you to the life and the work of the ordained ministry? Will you be faithful in prayer, in the study of the Holy Scriptures, and with the help of the Holy Spirit, continually rekindling the gift of God that is in you? Will you do your best to pattern your life in accordance with the teachings of Christ? And so in doing so, I will now hand out the license. And I will just read one, and they all read as such. First one, rightfully so, is to Minister Edna Sue Turner. This is to certify that Edna Turner has given the evidence that God has called her into the gospel ministry and was licensed to preach the gospel as she may have the opportunity and to exercise her gifts in the work of the ministry by Bishop Maurice C. Valentine at Life Changing Christian Center on the 18th day of April in the year of our Lord, 2021. And as we always say, keep following the way, preaching the truth, and living the life. Now go forth and change the life. Miss Minister Edna Turner. Minister, and this is a re-license to her, but Minister Crystal Neville. I love this man of God. Him and his wife are so faithful. They have been with us for a while, and I praise God for his service, his heart. Minister Todd Tryon. There you go. Yes, so awesome. This is an awesome one because this man of God was with us on our very first service. Matter of fact, the first time he preached at our very first sermon service, he was there. And he went off and now he's back home. Amen. He and his wonderful wife, in her absence, she's at home with the babies. Amen. I so praise God for him. He's another quiet assassin. Minister Derek Strickland. Brother here, he's older than I am. We grew up together, literally grew up together. He made these sandwiches that none of us to this day know what they were. But they were called specialty sandwiches. I'm just especially grateful to be alive after him. But man, I'm so proud of him because he has persevered, has stood strong, has stayed faithful to his calling. I'm proud of he and his wife. So now unto Minister Maurice Ball. Yeah. proud of that guy.
Yep.
Amen.
Oh,
man. Woo, y'all know we some proud babies. Amen. Y'all got it for real for me. I'm so proud of this man of God. When he first came, he was tough. I love it though. I love the fact of watching him grow and his trust. Because when you've been hurt, it's hard to believe, hard to trust again. But to watch he and his wonderful wife and his family grow into where they are today, I'm just so, so grateful and thankful to have him. And he's also going to be our minister of music. None other than Minister Scott Cobbs. He has a son, little pastor back there. Yeah, he showed no pastor. He preached a sermon so well that, who was it, Michael Todd? Michael Todd of Transformation Center, or Church, I'm sorry if I mess it up, please forgive me. But Michael Todd caught a wind of it and said, listen, you tell us whatever you want for your sanctuary, we're gonna write you a check for $5,000. And send it down there to him. And so he got his own little setup and little Alex back there. Raise your hand, Alex. There you go. Y'all check him out. Follow him on Facebook and YouTube. I gotta get him and Austin. Do some two preaching young men right there. We're gonna have a youth Sunday for them too. Amen. I thank God for this man of God. He is being elevated and we're affirmed. As deacon, we've been calling him deacon and he's been walking for years, but this will be the first time that we actually affirmed him as deacon, and he is so faithful. He is here. He was at the church before anybody got there, setting up, cleaning up. He cleaned up their high school better than the janitors there did. And most of the janitors, even, and this is true, the principal told us that the janitors love when y'all come because they clean up better. I told him, they're like, you must got a good cleaning crew. Man, it's only one and two of them. One and two. And so that's, but he serves in such a class that Apostle Skip Horton says as a class above first class, and it's called God class. And he serves in it well. So none other than Deacon Gary Neville. Definitely not least, this man of God has been with us. We met on a New Year's night, sitting across from each other, looking at each other. Didn't know what to say. But look, he dropped some nuggets, I dropped some nuggets, we tried to see where it go. And praise God, it has taken us a long way. He and his wife are so faithful. They were pastors in Huntsville and still are. Amazing, amazing men and women of God. Has a plethora of wisdom. And we are so grateful to have him. So this day we are affirming him in the office of elder. So we now certify to Pastor R.L. Turner. Amen. Go on and be yourself, brother. Hallelujah. Can we give a hand clap of praise? Hallelujah. Oh, you can do that, man. Come on and bless. Bless God. Amen. This is the first of many to come, and I'm so excited to have you all as a foundation to build upon. Thank you so much for your dedication, your prayers, your service, your heart. You guys are so amazing. So we're looking to go forth and go higher from here. Before we have the prayer, I do want to acknowledge that, raise your hand, Sister Danielle.
Daisy. We praise God that we're going to be shifting her to be our director. What are we? Event coordinator. Y'all, my mind messed up. Our event coordinator here at the church. She will be working in that area there. And so we're going to slowly transition her out of the youth ministry. But I praise God because they didn't know. But as soon as we had that conversation, we had the Summerlins to come and say, hey, we want to work in the youth ministry.
Come on now.
And so her and her husband would be shifting into the youth ministry. Raise our hand back there. Amen. Amen. Glory be to God. So I praise God for all the things that he is doing within this ministry. Man, and we're looking forward to growing forth. And anyone who wants to help in ministry and in help in building this ministry to continue to go forth, we're open with you, amen. So I'm going to ask if Apostle would come back and lead us in prayer over these awesome men and women of God. And before we, well, I'll do that first, amen.
You bow our heads to Heavenly Father, gracious Lord. Father, we just truly thank you for the elevation that is happening in this house. The precious men and women of God that have taken the office. And Father, we just ask you right now, as we said earlier, allow your Holy Spirit to rest upon them.
Yes.
But to rise mightily upon them as well. We pray for signs and wonders and miracles. We pray that, my Father, that each one of them will bring in a thousandfold of souls in the kingdom of God. And Father, we just pray right now that, my Father, that the people that are watching, that are here today, they receive not only the office of the people, but the anointing that's rest upon them as well. In the wonderful, gracious name of Jesus Christ, let the people of God say,
amen.
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 You have anything you would like to speak, First Lady? Amen.
I'm just excited. I do believe we have some definite armor in the house. I believe these 007 agents are going to take over. And it's just an honor to serve with you all. My heart is truly overwhelmed. I just thank God for each and every one of you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So at this time, before we depart out of here, I do want to say I thank God so much that my brother is here, Chicken George, and his wife, Deanna Yelder. Amen. And my little nieces and nephews back there. Amen. There you go, Lyric. I see you. They educated me on a lot of Bible stuff, and I thought I knew some stuff. They educated me. Amen. Also, would like to thank God for Pastor Derek here, man. Thank you. David, I'm sorry. I got you. I'm in the clouds. Amen. Pastor David and his wonderful wife and children. God bless y'all so much, man. Thank you so much for being here with us. God bless you, my brother. Thank you so much, man. Listen, I am full. I am just overwhelmed. We only grow higher from here. Just real quickly, just to share a few things that next Saturday, is it correct, Ms. TK? At 10 o'clock, we will be having a financial institute. Thank you. Amen. Financial empowerment seminar. Next Saturday at 10, from 10 to 12, it will be out in the parking lot. They will have it set out there in the parking lot for us to safely social distance out there. We will have Mr. Ray Perry and Ms. Takesha Motley and Mr. Danny Rose that will be doing some great teaching, helping us understand becoming financially independent. We met with them Monday. And they gave us a lot of great information. And we're going to be meeting with them again tomorrow evening to get more information. Setting up wills, the importance of wills and insurance and all of that is so important to know and have that information. But praise God, this is not something we're going to be doing once. This is going to be an annual and continual thing because we believe in empowerment. Amen. Amen. Praise God. We need to know how to make our money work for us rather than us working for money. Praise God. How many of y'all tired of chasing paper? Amen. And that's what we say. We chasing paper. You shouldn't be chasing paper. It should be chasing you. But if you don't know how to make it work, you'll be running after what should be running after you. Amen. Amen. So this is, we'll come out there next week for that. As well as next Saturday, we will be down at Ebenezer doing some work down there. This was the place that was hit by a storm. They're doing more giveaways down there next Saturday. And so I'll be in two places. I'll be up here and running down there. Because one thing about storms and the tragedy with that, one thing about when the news leaves, the prayers and the attention is gone as well. But just because the news isn't broadcasting doesn't mean they don't still need help. Amen. They still need it. It's going to take a long time. These people down there lost everything. Everything. So we want to continue to be a helping hand, not just once or twice. But we want to continuously be down there. So I'll be down there at Ebenezer. I'll be getting with Pastor Kim. She's be giving me more information about what the time. And I'll put that out there as well. And so I think that's it. Offering. Yes. Yes. Please forgive me for that. You can sow your seed physically back there on the offering box back there. You can do a Cash App, LifeChangingCC on Cash App, sowing a seed. And listen, man, once you sow this seed, as we learned in Jeremiah, the Bible says to direct your seed. Amen. Direct it. Direct it. Amen. So direct the roots of your seed. So put a name on that seed. So this seed here is the name, the seed of peace. Amen. You're not buying peace. You're just sowing into it. Amen. So this is a time that you want to sow in this move right here. Amen. And so if there's nothing else, are we good? Amen. I would like to take a picture with all of the everyone. So please, everyone up here, we can fellowship. But please come back so we can take a picture and get some photos of everyone. I see you shaking your head. No, CC. Nope. Got to get you. Amen. So if that's it, we good? All right, everybody standing. So repeat after me, keep following the way. Preaching the truth. And living the life. Because the life is good. Now look at your neighbor and say, now neighbor, go and change your life. God bless you guys. Have a great rest of your evening.